Well, hello and welcome to the Galaxy Moonbeam Night Site. We are the retro show that talks about everything and everything having to do with the memories that we enjoy and have enjoyed as baby boomers. You know, the ones that grew up in the mid-20th century and then all the way up until 1964. Welcome to the earliest baby boomers who are turning 50 this year. I'm Mike.
I'm Smitty.
And I'm George.
And we love to talk about the things, the culture, the items, the toys, the books, the movies, the notables, the celebrities, everything having to do with the memory banks that we still store as dear to us growing up. And as we age and get older, those are so important to us. And we also talk about some of the great ideas that occurred back in the 80s. When they said it was all said and done in the 70s, along came some contraptions that everybody had. Well, we talked earlier shows, Smitty, about the 50s. Everybody had to have a TV set.
Yes.
And around 55, you had to have one of those little wagon trains or the two Siamese cats, the lamp on the TV. Then when those broke and went to the Goodwill, you had to get another item on top of the TV set. And then you had to feed that monster at about $2 or $3 per feeding. And our good friend George Halilakos is going to shed some light on the subject of the world, that being the video rental stores. And it's my pleasure to bring my good pal George in to talk about this. Interesting. I have to run out, George, by the way. I've got a couple of VHSs, one of Greece, that I have to return to the shop. They told me it's about $9,023 in penalty fees. Be right back, but you take it away. Dazzle, my friend.
That might be just enough to cover the closure and bankruptcy costs. We recently marked the end of an era, not only in the context of retailing, but also in the video industry. Blockbuster Video closed its door for business not long ago. And this is an industry that began in the very early 1980s. It was largely comprised of mom-and-pop owner-operator stores in your local neighborhood. It was a fragmented industry, that is, the video rental industry was. And it wasn't until the mid-1980s that Blockbuster Video, when they opened their first store in Dallas, Texas, revolutionized this industry. And by the 1990s, they were not only nationwide, but worldwide. And what they did was that they were able to capitalize on the huge demand for videos and video rentals by customizing the stores to fit the neighborhood according to specific demographic profiles. And in addition to maintaining the popular list of new releases at the time, they had a very sizable collection of catalog titles. Well, they continued to flourish in the 90s. They adapted new technologies, including DVDs, then later Blu-ray. They also incorporated offering movie snack foods. But an interesting event occurred in the year 2000, and at the time it was virtually ignored, but it came back to bite them. And they passed on the opportunity to purchase Netflix. And this proved to be a very disastrous turn of events, because by the end of the decade, Netflix, with its explosive growth and also the trend of streaming online and the increased supply of titles available for purchase at better price value points versus the rental, led to the eventual demise and closure of the Blockbuster model. Before I turn it over to you guys, I just wanted to share a couple of observations and memories about Blockbuster. We remember, of course, that they tended to stock more copies of new movies rather than older releases to capitalize on the latest trends of the day. But they were also marketing themselves as a family-oriented chain. They never rented or sold pornographic content in the United States markets. However, the stores did carry unrated, R-rated, or soft porn, but with very tight restrictions. And it was this framework that allowed them to achieve enormous success right from the get-go because of their family-friendly atmosphere. They provided a very positive shopping experience. Not only did they offer pleasant surroundings, allowing for easy browsing, but also easy checkout and returns. Lots of fun offerings to make you feel like you were at the theater, except able to take it home. And it finally manifested itself with some very popular advertising slogans. Your ticket to entertainment. Make it a Blockbuster night. Bring the good times home. And perhaps those of you that enjoy some of the great advertisements associated with Super Bowl may recall that in 2002, Blockbuster introduced Carl and Ray. And they were a rabbit and a guinea pig in a pet store located across the street from a neighborhood Blockbuster outlet. And they were voiced by James Belushi and James Wood, and it was later reactivated for the 2007 Super Bowl. And they capitalized on the popularity of these characters with some plush toys bearing their likeness that had pull-string activated voices of these two characters. And it was sold at all the Blockbuster stores to go along with their regular merchandise. So it's hard to believe that we've come full circle. We started out with Beta, and then we went to VHS, then we went to DVDs and Blu-ray, then streaming online, and Blockbuster is now gone. So I was going to ask if you guys have any favorite memories about Blockbuster or your thoughts about this industry. It's hard to believe that 30 years have come and gone so quickly.
It is hard to believe, George. I remember back in the mid-80s, my friends and I, we all had Beta machines. I still have Beta machines. I still have my entire collection of over 600 Beta tapes and my machines. At that time, there was no place like Blockbuster or any other chains that you would go. You would go to a little neighborhood mom-and-pop rental place, and there was one in the neighborhood where my friends lived, and so we would go there and we would rent movies, and it was just kind of a cool thing. Wow, you can actually rent these movies, take them home, watch them, and then bring them back and rent more movies, and it was just kind of a neat concept. This, again, was before the internet, before the ability for you to order your own copy of whatever movie it might be. I think the concept of owning a tape really wasn't really all there. I think it was mostly the concept of that you're going to rent this and you're going to watch it and you're going to enjoy it, then you're going to bring it back and then you can rent something else. And it is interesting how technology has caught up with the early rental of videotapes. Of course, now we have DVDs. We also have distribution online, which such as Netflix and streaming services that you can subscribe to, and you can certainly purchase DVDs galore at places such as Amazon. So the availability of a motion picture to the public is now much easier than it was when a Blockbuster first started. So they were definitely fulfilling a need that had brought about by the proliferation of home videotape machines.
And I think there was also restricted supply as well. I mean, as I recall, if you wanted to purchase some of these titles, correct me if I'm wrong, Mike, weren't the titles in excess of $100 to $200?
Oh, if you could find them. And there were certain stores where you could find them. They were $89. I remember Grease mentioning back, my wife and I were so thrilled. We went out to Hollywood to, I believe, Pantages and watched Grease. And we were just so thrilled. It was just brought back so many memories and our favorite stars, Olivia Newton. Well, we had to go own that for ourselves. And very few, as you guys mentioned, very few videos would you like enough to go buy. And we went out there. It was $89, I think, at Sears. $89 to own that, so we did not buy it. But the other thing was the idea of it was almost a ritual. Friday nights was video night at my house, my wife and I. She would get home from work about 3-4 o'clock, and she would stop at the store, go to the video shop, maybe pick up something else, and that became almost an American suburban ritual, was movie night.
It still is in our house.
Yeah.
We still do it, except we are very fortunate that we either DVR it or we have the DVDs that we own that we love so very much.
Well, this was a time before the video cassettes and the video rental shops. They climbed all the way to the ceiling almost. Right. Yeah. Now you go up there. Yeah, I wanted Sands of Iwo Jima up there. Anybody got the stepladder? But Beta had a section, usually at the back quarter of the store. And the Beta selections, I always thought, Beta's cool. I wonder what the difference is, because I must have a Beta deck, but I don't, and I never was able to get one. And then you had three sections. Well, you had the counter, and it was mom and pop, and you had the VHS center, and then you had the Beta center, and then the store, some of the stores had the black curtain, which had the X-rated center, which was always in the back. And that's how these stores flourished. But in our town, when we left L.A. and went to a town in San Diego called Poway, there were family video shops, which I was so glad Blockbuster followed that pattern. You notice Blockbuster always put the family videos in the front of the store, George. You didn't have to go through the the Monterey Park Machete Massacre to get to the Disney
always
stuff.
It was always displayed right up front.
Laid out, very clean. Magically enough, with their marketing prowess, they always had the snacks there in the waiting line when you were waiting to get. And it was a long line on a Friday or Saturday.
We call it product placement and point of purchase.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Calorie Boulevard, because what? Okay, then you're going to get your Raisinets and your licorice, of course. Yes.
And your popcorn.
And your popcorn. Yes, your movie time popcorn. Kind of reminds me now of the checkout line when you go to Fry's. They make you wind around, and the aisles are just loaded with candy and all kinds of goodies and all kinds of little things. So that ploy has been around for a long time.
Well, and you know, as the mom and pops, and I did research, too, knowing you were going to produce this story, George, the mom and pops had a shelf life because they were independent and they were fragmented, but they had a shelf life of about 8 years, they figured, from the time of the first video rental booths or shops to the end, when all of those little shops all over the face of the United States became hair salons and manicure centers, or just basically squashed right out of business.
Yeah.
Like several big box stores we know of have done to mom-and-pop stores. And you wonder what happened, but you really don't, because technology ruined the mom-and-pop. Technology in the sense of mom-and-pops had 8 years, and you could go in and you could rent your movie. You can actually call in and reserve your movie. Mm-hmm. And it would be there waiting for you. As long as you had your little ID card, you were fine. Mm-hmm. Along came something called DVD.
Mm-hmm.
And by the way, George, did you rewind? Be kind, please rewind.
Yes.
Some of those stores were not so kind. It was 50 cents if you don't rewind.
Yeah, they could really ding you.
Yeah.
And if you didn't rewind it, and they'd check the tape and the cassettes, and there were occasions where you get frustrated because you go and put the cassette in and it was broken or it was fuzzy, it was fragmented, it wasn't tracking properly.
Yeah. Oh, the tracking was always very frustrating.
Yes.
And you had the smallest, most useless knob on the VHS deck was the tracking on the remote, because it would take you to that level of distortion or the other level of distortion. You'd never find the median, would you, Smitty?
Oh, no. Never. The tracking was always very critical, and it was always sometimes even in the middle of a movie, you'd have to adjust the tracking because the tracking would drift.
Yeah, it would drift. Colors would drift. Packaging would split. It was a hassle, but it's all we knew. Again, as we talked on our computer segment of Galaxy, we didn't know any different. It was so cool. It was so great. You get to the DVR world, and guess what? That's when Blockbuster really started to kick in, if you notice. You could still get VHS cassette tapes at the Blockbuster, but the DVDs came in, and what happened? You could get more movies for more people, because let's talk about the other frustration, which was even more humiliating, was to get there. Okay, 3 o'clock's when the crowd starts. I get there, too, because I want to watch Die Hard tonight. And how hard you would die when you found out that the only 3 copies in that store were rented out between 12 and 1:30, and you're there at 2:25, you died hard. And that was the other problem. You could put so many more DVDs in the rack with that movie title, especially the new releases, George.
Yes.
You could get there. If you got there at 3, there's a good chance you were going to get a copy of Die Hard on DVD, because they had 20 of them if they were a new release.
Mm-hmm.
The thing that I think is so interesting about the video rentals was that I can remember when to have your own movie was a true sign of luxury. I recall during the 1970s, during my many trips that I did with my mom to go back to visit her family in Texas, that we were guests in the home of this gentleman who happened to own an oil company. He also happened to be a classic film buff, and he invited all of us to attend a screening in his home of the movie All About Eve, which happens to be my wife's favorite film with Bette Davis and Ann Baxter.
Mm-hmm.
And this man had literally a private theater, and it was a big reel-to-reel film that he had where he had to change it and set it. And this was an example of luxury. That's in 1977. Now, by the mid-80s, these films are starting to become available on VHS for rental. And by the early 90s, you're able to purchase them.
Mm-hmm.
And so in basically about a 10-year time frame, to get a classic movie where you have to wait to see it on the late show, or you'd have to have mega bucks to have your own home theater, this now made it accessible to everyone. And I think it really had a dramatic effect on our pop culture, because this also started to bring about what people called staycations. People would mm-hmm. stay at home and relax and watch video games. They would have opportunities, you know, to do get-togethers with friends. And it changed a lot about how we would socialize and engage with each other. And I think, as you correctly noted, Mike, technology changed once again.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
I think what's so ironic about Blockbuster, and I don't mean to be critical, because as the rule is that the future is unpredictable. Can you imagine if they had been able to purchase Netflix?
They had a chance to.
They had the chance, and they passed up on it.
At a dirt cheap price, by the way, and we won't go into the metrics of how cheap that was versus how valuable that company is today.
But it does show that nothing stays the same, particularly in the realm of technology. And I think what you mentioned about the 8-year life cycle for a video rental store is very surprising, because my godbrother, Christy yep. Limbesis, who we profiled in an earlier show, he actually spent time for several years working for a family-owned video store, and he really enjoyed it because he was so knowledgeable about the industry and the classic films, and he was a very helpful video sales clerk.
Well, yeah. And if you loved movies, especially to the degree that we love this stuff, it was a good place to work. But it was even better to know the guy who owned the place, because he knew what you liked.
Yes.
And that's one thing mm-hmm. you couldn't find at Blockbuster was a, I'm not age discriminating, but yes, I am. Because we can do that here, because we don't have to be politically correct here at Galaxy Moonbeam Night Site. A 17-year-old kid coming to an high school job part-time is not going to say, oh, might be that. I think he would like this one, and there's only 3 copies. I better give him a call. But my guy down there at the shack, the video shack, he would call me.
Yeah.
And I thought that was important. But it went back to the mom and pop corner store, George.
It did,
where you'd
indeed.
Go get a knee-high soda and a bag of chips, and you knew the lady. And
yes.
She had the pictures of her kids up there.
A different era. And I think it's interesting that, as I said, that when we mark the end of the era, it's not only in terms of video technology, as I said, for the retailing industry. And it reflects the changes in terms of how we engage, how we consume, how we enjoy things.
Well, how we enjoy things, and we are getting to be a lazy bunch, we are, because you don't have to go anywhere to get your entertainment for Friday night other than to the remote on your coffee table or your big stuffed recliner couch. And you're buying in Netflix, back to Netflix, they're selling something thousands and thousands of times that you will never physically touch, that they don't have to reproduce, that they don't have to account for if one is never returned, that they don't have to administer the late fees on. And that is just incredible. When I say technology has taken over, believe me, technology took over the video rental business, because now... Do we have our wave bye-bye hats on, fellas? 1, 2, 3, bye-bye, Redbox. They're going to go out soon, too. And mm-hmm. per our discussion in the last few minutes, you can see why. I go down to my favorite grocery store, Stater Brothers, and it's a Saturday afternoon, and there's 4 people in front of me at the Redbox. And I get my chance, and persons 3 and 4 just took the last 2 copies of the DVD I wanted. Full circle, the show we are. And it's a physical effort. We want gratification and instant delivery. Mm-hmm. And that's what technology is giving us hourly almost. Well, we're going to wrap this up. And you know what? If I can get this remote to activate the rewind button and play this segment back, I will take time to thank my good friend George over there and Smitty, because this was an interesting piece. This was something that just about everybody, I would say, almost everyone who listens to us can relate to, the days of the video rental shop. And good work, good production, George, as usual. We're going to roll to a retromercial here on Galaxy Moonbeam Night Site, but don't go away. If you don't like the commercial, just don't buy the stuff the guy's selling. But hang on, come right back. We'll be right here. Don't go away.
When you get together for a Blockbuster night, there's never a line to get in. There's no cover charge, there's no reservation required, and the kitchen never closes. With over 9,000 Blockbuster videos to choose from, we'd like to suggest that when it comes to a great night with friends, There's no place like home. There's no place like home. Make it a Blockbuster night.
Hi, I'm Larry Van Eyes, and you are listening to Galaxy Moonbeam Night Site on the Galaxy Nostalgia Network.
Okay, make it a Blockbuster night. All right, good. Okay. Anyway, back to Galaxy Moonbeam Night Site. I'm just shuddering at the thought of going down and parking and walking into my Blockbuster only to be told that they were out of the red whips. No, that was not the Arnold Schwarzenegger movie. That was the candy in the checkout line.
Exactly.
But again, George, what a good piece there. Welcome back to Galaxy Moonbeam Night Site. We are the retro show that goes back and talks about everything that happened when we as baby boomers were growing up. It just seems like, unfortunately, on every show, we're losing someone that meant a whole lot to us on TV, screen, books, acting. You know, it's just they're going at a rate that we've been at this show a number of years now,
yeah,
Smitty.
I know.
It seems like we used to do these a few times a year, and now if we did a show every other day, we'd have someone to talk about. In this case, someone we can talk about who really knew how to talk, especially when it came to the gibberish. That's where I learned it from, Smitty.
Yes.
None other than one of our best buddies growing up on TV, Sid Caesar. And Sid Caesar passed away, Smitty, and we were talking about him a few months ago, Sid Caesar, wondering where he was, 91 years old.
91 years old, yeah.
But what do you remember?
Yeah, Sid Caesar, well, certainly one of the well-remembered pioneers of early television and, of course, motion pictures and so many of the things that he did. But Sid Caesar passed away on February 12th of 2014. Sid Caesar, not a stand-up comedian, but he was considered more of a sketch comic and actor. Certainly made his mark in the early days of television with Your Show of Shows, which you probably may remember that he performed on that program with Imogene Coca, and Carl Reiner, and so many others. He was really a very active individual who utilized, again, as we said, he was not a stand-up comedian, but he relied more on his body language, on facial accents, facial contortions, and dialogue to get the point across. He was not the kind of a person that would tell a joke, because he always said that the joke would go by too quickly, so he wanted to make a little story out of it. But he was born on September 8th, 1922. His parents owned a restaurant in New York, and he began to learn the technique of double talk, which was sort of a gibberish that he would do. It would sound like he was talking a foreign language, but he really wasn't. It was just a bunch of sound, and he learned that by waiting tables at the restaurant, and he would try to imitate, which he did imitate, the sort of the dialect sound of Italians, Poles, Russians, and so many other ethnic groups. At a very young age, he was about 14 years old when he became a saxophonist and began his work with one of the first bands that he was involved with. He graduated from Yonkers High School in 1939, and he was working toward a musical career in the 1940s, early 40s, 1942. He was working in the Catskill Mountains and working with such musicians, such orchestra leaders as Shep Fields, Claude Thornhill, Charlie Spivak, and Benny Goodman, of all people. So he was really not only of a comedic nature, but also had a musical background as well. He appeared during the war in a service review called Tars and Spars, and that's where he was noticed at first time by the director of the program, Max Liebman. After the war, Sid Caesar moved to Hollywood, where he did a motion picture version of this, and together with Mr. Liebman, Max Liebman, they approached television, and they went into TV in 1948 when he made his first appearance on Texaco Star Theater, and in 1949, Sid Caesar appeared on his first series, which was called Admiral Broadway Review, which was sponsored by the Admiral Corporation that made radios and televisions and appliances. And that program was simulcast. It was broadcast on NBC and Dumont at exactly the same time, which was really, really interesting. Of course, Your Show of Shows premiered shortly thereafter, where he worked with, again, as we mentioned, with Imogene Coca followed a few years later by his program Caesar's Hour. And there were other programs that came along, such as Sid Caesar Invites You, and many other programs, also known as the Sid Caesar Show, where he also had many, many celebrity guest stars. And, of course, on motion pictures, it's a mad, 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 mad world that he appeared in. And he also appeared in Grease. He also appeared in History of the World, Part 1, and Cannonball Run. There were so many movies and so much that we could talk about. Guys, George, Mike, any memories of watching Sid Caesar on television?
Well, I think about Sid Caesar, and I sort of liken him to what we consider in NFL football, the coaching tree. You look at people that achieved great distinction in their career, having been associated with Sid Caesar and learning from him. Mm-hmm. And the number of people that wrote for Sid Caesar included, but were not limited to, Mel Brooks, Neil Simon, Carl Reiner, Woody Allen. All of them wrote for Sid Caesar. All of them have gone on to have great and successful careers. And as you noted, he was multi-generational, because not only did he appear in Grease, but he also appeared in the 1990s with Vegas Vacation.
Mm-hmm, sure.
So he became known to a lot of different generations of movie fans everywhere.
I love Sid Caesar in Grease, mainly because Grease is one of my favorite movies, and because he did it so well. He was a natural. As a funny man, Sid Caesar could take live, and this was back, there was a genre called live comedy TV.
Mm-hmm.
There was no script. Very little was done on script when there was a script. And we talked earlier, Sid Caesar worked on a very thin high wire with no safety net. One take. When those cameras rolled, you were going. And he would bungle lines, but the thing is, no one knew. But imagine a guy, and you would think it would be easy to do gibberish. It's very difficult to do good gibberish.
Yeah.
But Sid Caesar mastered it to a point where he was the most number one well-liked funny man. Well, there were very few in that time, but your show of shows, people would come home early, they'd do their groceries early so they could get in time to see the shows and watch Sid Caesar to see what he's going to do. And so they match him with this other maniac, this little gal with these big bug eyes, with this facial expression, Imogene Coca, and you put those two together. Now, comedy, folks, now, we're not even going to begin to try to convince you that comedy in 1950 was the same as comedy in 2014, because it's not. You had certain standards and guidelines, and imagine I'm back to that tightrope. There are certain things you could say on TV, and there are certain things you could do. There are certain things you could get away with doing. There's a few things that you may be called in for doing. There's things you never did. So imagine that line you had to stay on at all times, multiple shows, multiple series, all non-scripted, all ad-libbed, and all on live TV. None of the guys today or the gals have that type of opportunity. Sid Caesar was a master at the craft of pioneering early live television.
Absolutely. Sid Caesar was a very unique personality. He was loved by his writers, and certainly his talent spanned the years, as George mentioned, multi-generational. So we remember Sid Caesar, who passed away this February 12th of 2014. And that brings us to the end of our program. We sure thank you for joining us. We want to remind you that we would love to hear from you. If you have any memories of Sid Caesar, or of going down to Blockbuster and renting your favorite movie, why don't you drop us a line? Our email address is galaxymoonbeamnightsite@gmail.com. Our website is galaxymoonbeamnightsite.com. And don't forget the Galaxy Moonbeam Nightsite page on Facebook. We sure hope that you'll look in and check out what we're doing. So, until next time, I'm Smitty.
I'm Mike.
And I'm George.
And we look forward to having you again with us next time on Galaxy Moonbeam Night Site on the Galaxy Nostalgia Network. This is the Galaxy Nostalgia Network.